Okay, well, we're going to start with this first clinical case, and it will help us to go through the issues of HBV care and management, just to be sure that we have clear ideas about the issues. So this is the true story of Mrs. Candida. This is not her real name. She was 43 years old, and she was living in France for 2 years. When she got systematic screening at a voluntary testing center, she turned to be HIV-1 positive, HBsAg positive, HCV antibody negative. After this first screening, she went to our clinic, and she got the first evaluation. So you can see more results. The CD40 cells were 700. HIV RNA was a little over 15,000 copies. She was HBe antigen negative, HBe antibody positive. And she had a replicating hepatitis B, not very high, as you can see, 32,000 units. AST and ALT were two, three times above normal. So she was classified as a precore mutant chronic hepatitis B because she had a replicating hepatitis but no HBe antigen. And the renal function was normal at that time. So considering those first elements, would you wait or would you treat her? Just, of course, we would like to have more details, more clinical exams, etc., but just to start thinking about the case. So she's not very immunosuppressed, so first you would not give any treatment because the CD4T cells is over 500 and much over 500. Or second option, you would treat HBV only because this is a precore mutant, and we know that hepatitis B with precore mutant is more aggressive. And there is, here again, no indication for HIV treatment, or you would like to treat both virus. So who would go for the first option?
Anybody want to go for option one? No. Okay, option two. Anybody want to treat just the hepatitis B? Okay, option three.
Right, treatment for both HIV and HBV. So why should treatment be initiated early? Evidence from databases, a Greek cohort, there is a 36 excess risk of dying of all cause in patients with HBs positivity compared to HBs negativity. And this is the max cohort from the States, and this is a recent paper just published in CID at beginning of the year. And as you can see, this is the first study showing that mortality is higher in patients infected with HBV compared to patients infected with HCV when there is a co-infection with HIV. But there was no difference between HCV and HBV regarding all causes of death. So why should treatment be initiated against boy viruses? And for that, we have evidence from the bench, and I think this very intricate role between HIV and HBV. And you have a few references here. This is the first paper which really proved that HIV is penetrating hepatic stellate cells. So when there is two viruses in the cells, you can imagine that the liver is not going very well. And this role of HIV is really synergistic with the impact of HBV, as you can see here, because it induced an alteration of innate and adaptive immune response. And there is this very nice paper here showing that there is a modification of the toll-like receptors, which are pathogen recognition receptors, and there is a modification of their course of expression by HIV and also HBV, and it has been shown in 2009. And this triggers a pro-inflammatory signaling cascade and then increase of fibrosis. So the role of HBV and HIV is starting to be deciphered, and it's really intricate. Before initiating treatment, do you think that the first evaluation should be completed? So no, because the initial blood tests are sufficient. Yes, you would do hepatitis C antibody, maybe PCR, you would do hepatitis delta serology, and that's all? Or you think you would add liver staging and grading to the above?
Who wants to do nothing? Anybody? Anybody want to do just delta and hepatitis C? Okay. Anybody want to do liver staging and grading?
Okay. So first, how to optimize screening and initial evaluation? I think we are getting better and better. To prove that to you, I went back to those two APB survey that we did in France, 2005 and 2008, to show you that we are getting better in first evaluating the virus before treating. As you can see here, this is 2005 and this is 2008. In those two studies, we compared HBV monoinfected versus HBV co-infected. But by taking the two surveys, we also compared HBV co-infected in 2005 versus HBV co-infected in 2008. And as you can see, we are doing better in virological evaluation, and we are doing better in fibrosis evaluation. And in 2008, we have reached 70% of evaluation before treatment initiation. And as you can see here, there is a decrease of liver biopsy between 2005 and 2008, and an increase in FibroScan, which might not be the best way to do things, but we still perform quite a lot of biopsies. So those two studies are the only one to evaluate non-invasive tools in HIV-HBV co-infected patients, so be careful if you use only those methods. Very important to screen for hepatitis delta and hepatitis C, because the course of natural history or history under treatment of HBV co-infected patients is very different when there is a delta or a C co-infection. So what molecule would you use to treat this patient? You would go for a 12-month course of PEG interferon and ARVs. You would go for ARVs and entecavir, or you would go for an ARV regimen with dual activity drugs.
Okay, so should we start at the bottom and work upwards? Who wants to go for three?
Very good. Some patients, if they are young, if they are HBe positive, low HBV DNA, and high transaminases, you might go for a one-year course of PEG interferon, because there is a pretty good chance that you cure this patient, especially if TD4 are high. So your treatment guidelines, you've just maybe to say a few words about this option here, because it's in the guidelines, especially in patients where you don't want to introduce ART. And we see this kind of patients in our clinics. Some patients have more than 1,000 CD4 cells, and the fibrosis, the hepatitis B is pretty mild, and we don't want to introduce treatment. So if they have those criteria, we might go for a PEG interferon course, 1 year PEG interferon course. And it's even better tolerated in HBV-infected patients than it is in HCV-infected patients. But those patients are quite rare. Most of the time, as Christina told you this morning, we want to start treatment earlier. So a word about PEG interferon. This is a pretty disappointing strategy in HIV-infected patients. Many strategies have been evaluated in HIV-infected patients, either PEG interferon alone or combined with adefovir or tenofovir. But until now, this kind of strategy has not been shown to be efficient. But there is an ongoing pilot trial in France called EnviPEG, and we'll hopefully have the results before the end of this year, because we've been waiting for the result for 4 years, I think. But we've had some difficulties to recruit patients in the trial. That was a big problem. And this trial is evaluating a strategy of tenofovir for at least 6 months in co-infected patients, then peginterferon alpha 2A was added for 48 weeks. So we should have the results by the end of the year. Unfortunately, only 47 patients were included in this trial. We don't think that on a population level, the use of peginterferon is a good option, but maybe in some very selected patients, it might, you know, good to try. So after 1 year of treatment with a tripla, this woman had an undetectable HIV viral load, undetectable HBV DNA, and the CD4 T cells went up more than 900, so very good results. FibroScan and FibroTest performed regularly, because that's what we do in our clinic. In those patients, we perform two non-invasive tests per year, and if they are concordant, we don't do liver biopsy. So at a routine screening, although she had normal transaminases for a very long time, she had this time elevated transaminases and no cholestasis. So what could be the etiology for this hepatic flare? You think she might have viral comorbidity, hepatotoxicity, and maybe efavirenz, considering her regimen, metabolic comorbidities like NASH, or all the above?
So, what do we think? Do you think it could be one of the acute viral infections? That's possible, couldn't it? You know, we don't have data on whether she was immune to hepatitis A or not.
Exactly.
And, you know, we don't know whether she's been at risk for getting hepatitis C or even Delta
superinfection.
Yep.
Co-infection, yeah.
Okay, so that's a possibility. What about hepatotoxicity with efavirenz? Do you think that's likely to happen? How long has she been on a tripla for?
1 year, sorry.
So is that possible? That's a really good question. Do you think we can get late toxicity with drugs like efavirenz? Patrick?
Yes, if it would be too late, I wouldn't rule it out, but in my opinion, it's a bit late, actually.
Okay, what about the metabolic comorbidity? Yeah, as Mo told you this morning, yesterday, metabolic comorbidity might induce increased of transaminases. So what would be your option? Four. Okay. Yeah, you're right. To show you something that Christina told you about this morning, hepatic flares, it's a pretty frequent in HIV-HBV co-infection. So as you can see, 13% per year of follow-up. So it's not a small incidence. And the etiologies are very diverse. So you have to think about HBV immune restoration under ARV. Well, she's been on treatment for 1 year, so it's a little bit late for immune restoration. But during this immune restoration, there is a production of cytokines, and one of those cytokines, the TXCL10, is a pro-fibrogenic factor. So it might induce elevation of transaminases and fibrogenesis as well. You can see HBV reactivation at treatment interruption, and there is a very high risk of fulminant hepatitis with mutant emergence. There is ARV hepatotoxicity, and of course, NASH, lipodystrophy, insulin resistance induced by ARVs. And of course, please do not forget hepatitis delta co-infection. And it's very, very important to screen patients every year for hepatitis delta. Okay, so how would you monitor this patient? Remember, FibroScan, FibroTest showed the F3 score in fibrosis. So you think she's close to cirrhosis, and because she's HIV positive, she has to be considered like cirrhotic patients. So US and blood screening every 6 months or once a year, because HCC screening is enough in our case. So what would you do? Would you go for the first option, 6 months screening? Okay.
The doubling size time, if you will, for an average hepatoma is anything from 3 to 6 months. And if you think that the limit of detection for ultrasound is between 1 and 2 centimetres, if you go to yearly screening, then by the time you detect a nodule, it's going to be too big probably to provide curative treatment with curative intent. So if you're going to, the choice is either you do surveillance or you don't do surveillance. And if you're going to do surveillance, then the best interval is 6 monthly.
Just a word about screening for HCC. There is an emerging role of hepatocellular carcinoma in our patients. And And in HBV monoinfection, there is a very strong link between ESLD and HBV DNA. So really important to control our patients with very effective drugs. But the prognosis after liver transplantation for HIV-HBV patients is really good, because there is a French study showing that there is 100% survival at three years. HCC screening is essential. Really, really, really important. And you should not forget to screen for varices as well in cirrhotic patients. So now, Candida is well controlled with treatment. She's got stabilized liver disease, very mild immunosuppression. This flare in transaminases was probably due to metabolic syndrome. Because she's not obese, but she's overweight, and this is a feature that we see more and more often now in our patient. And she takes drugs against hypertension and dyslipidemia. I tried to put her on exercise for overweight, but it's really, really difficult. Especially, I don't know, but it's my experience, especially in our migrant population, very difficult to bring them to the gym and swimming and et cetera, et cetera. So at a routine visit, she had those blood tests, a creatinine clearance, which clearly decreased during those 3 years of follow-up. Phosphoremia level was a little bit low. The calcemia level was normal. She had proteinuria and no glycosuria. So she underwent renal ultrasound, and the kidneys were of subnormal size, and there was what we call a cortical differentiation in French, but it might not be the good word in English, I don't know.
I think that's an acceptable word, yeah?
Okay, okay, so. So what would you do with those renal results? You think it's a TDF-associated nephropathy called the Fanconi syndrome, so you would immediately stop tenofovir and replace by another drug. Or you would check phosphoremia again, or you would keep tenofovir but adapt the dosing, or you would refer the patient to a nephrologist. For myself, I decided to refer her to a nephrologist because I don't know anything about nephrology. And apart from the fact that I could check again the phosphoremia, and the phosphoremia was a little bit higher but still borderline, I consider that she would be better treated with a nephrologist advice. Just remind you about this Fanconi syndrome. We were in St. Antoine Hospital the first to publish a clinical case about this with our nephrologist team for a nearby hospital back in 2002. But data about renal insufficiency or renal clearance on the long term in HIV-HBV patients are pretty reassuring. For example, in our cohort of 308 patients that we have followed for 3 years, 240 patients could be included in this sub-study. They all had normal glomerular filtration rates at baseline. And as you can see, we did two groups, one with tenofovir and one with other nukes. And when they've been followed for 3 years in parallel groups, we saw that the creatinine clearance was pretty stable over time. So in patients on a short follow-up, because 3 years is a short follow-up, we don't see any big impact of tenofovir in those co-infected patients. But there are existing data on renal and bone impairment over time in HIV-infected patients on long-term use of tenofovir. So it should not be different in co-infected patients. So we have to bear in mind that in those patients in whom we can't stop the treatment, especially tenofovir, because we don't have any other efficient drugs, we might see on the long term some renal impairment and bone impairment as well. But also do not forget that creatinine clearance is going down as a physiological witness of age. And I got a letter yesterday by email from the nephrologist I'm working with about one of my patients who is 62 years old now. And I've been following him for 12 years. And he's been on tenofovir for 8 years. And I got recently very worried because I saw that the creatinine clearance was going down and he had some degree of proteinuria and no glycosuria, but the phosphor level was going down as well. And I thought he had the mild Fanconi syndrome. And so I refer him to the nephrologist. And she sent a letter yesterday saying that this is physiological decrease of creatinine clearance, and all the tests she did ruled out nephropathy, tubular nephropathy due to tenofovir. So we have to bear in mind that in our aging patient, that might be a normal evolution of creatinine clearance with age. So the EX guidelines published last year recommend to look for all other causes than tenofovir if there is a renal impairment, and go to renal biopsy if you can't be sure of the renal etiology, especially in co-infected patients, because tenofovir is such an essential drug in these patients. And if there is renal impairment, if there is mild Fanconi syndrome and you can't get rid of tenofovir, you have to adjust the dosing to the renal clearance. You give one pill every 2 days, and you can even go one pill every 3 days because the dosing of tenofovir for hepatitis B is really high, and we know that there is a long half-life of the drug, and even if you give it every 3 days, the patient will be covered efficiently for HBV, which might not be the case for HIV, but so you have to give a very strong regimen for HIV aside tenofovir. So the last issue we had to tackle with, so after the patient has been referred to the nephrologist, the final diagnosis after renal biopsy, and she, the nephrologist went until the renal biopsy because there was a this issue of treating HBV with tenofovir, and I was very worried about that on the long term. So she decided to perform this renal biopsy, and she told me that this patient has nephrangiosclerosis, so it's associated with hypertension. So she was kept on tenofovir, so Truvada, but it was adapted to renal function, so one pill every 2 days, and I replaced efavirenz by darunavir. Just to be sure that for HIV I had the most effective ARV treatment. So 1 year later, so that's 4 years after introducing treatment for HIV Hep B, and another routine check, we saw that HBV DNA was not undetectable anymore, and all the other blood tests were normal. This patient was still suppressed for HIV, and the immunosuppression was stable. So I repeated HBV DNA again 2 months later, and then again 2 months later. So I saw kind of fluctuation in HBV DNA. So what do you think? Maybe this patient is selectively not taking Truvada. So she's failing HBV therapy, but not HIV because she's on darunavir. And we know that monotherapy of darunavir is effective. You think she has developed tenofovir resistance while being exposed to tenofovir in the long term. And above that, she's now on a suboptimal dosing of tenofovir. Or, like me, you don't have any idea. So this is the definition of suboptimal virological response in those patients. There is a flattening of HBV DNA decrease, usually following a sharp viral decay, and then there is a fluctuation between 12, which is the limit of detection for most HBV tests, and 1,000 units. And the etiology, so it's not clear, that's why we can't really say we know why, except if there is non-adherence. So the etiology of suboptimal virological response is not clear. There might be an impaired host immune response, maybe some HBS mutants virus evading host defenses. But a lot of studies have shown that there is no polymerase mutant virus against tenofovir. Only strains with this mutation, A194T, have been proved to have a decrease in tenofovir sensitivity in vitro, but it doesn't translate in vivo failure. So until now, we have no clear response for those low replicating HBV patients. So the management is not really clear. The only other option we have is maybe add entecavir, especially in patients who have no resistance to lamivudine, because when there is a proved resistance to lamivudine, there is no way that entecavir might work. So we don't really know what to do. We don't really know why. We have this situation, we don't really know what to do, so that's why I think it's one of the biggest challenges we're going to have to face in the coming years. Thank you.